honor to be here. Last year I did this for about, I was given half hour, and I think I went close to 45 minutes. So today I know I have only 10 minutes worth.
I think we gave you 20.
But anyway, it's my pleasure to be here. So I'm going to focus on three questions. What is functional assessment? Why does one need it? And of course, then how does one do functional assessment? And that last question is basically the focus of my talk, and I'm going to break it down into three different areas: implants that preserve or attempt to preserve motion at a joint, implants that eliminate motion at a joint, joint fusion implants, and of course the fracture fixation implants. So how do you assess their biomechanical function? So what is, very briefly, what is functional biomechanical assessment? Essentially, the aim is to assess whether or not the implant as it is designed meets its design objective when it is implanted in its biological environment. And this kind of assessment in the lab can be done using various approaches, experiments on cadaveric specimens. Of course, computer modeling or mathematical modeling, such as finite element analysis. One can always use animal, not always, but often use animal models, or combination of any number of these. Why does one need to do functional assessment? It's essentially used to distinguish your product or your design from that of your competitors. And of course, it also provides ideas for future improvements in your idea and new implant designs. So, for example, if you look at the case of cervical disc replacements, these are only few of the many, many cervical disc implants that are available that are approved through the FDA process and used to alleviate painful symptoms in the degenerative neck. So if you have a new idea for a cervical implant, you have to demonstrate how that differs from the existing designs so that you can market it appropriately. And of course, the next item why one needs to do biomechanical assessment is to optimize the function of your design. And it fits very nicely in this continuous cycle of continuous improvement known as the Deming's PDCA cycle. So it begins with the first phase is to plan or identify the need for a new product. You design and fabricate the initial prototypes. And of course, first thing you have to do is do the ASTM or ISO standard testing, which is what Dawn and her group does so well. And of course, once it meets the safety criteria, then the next question you should address is, does it meet its design objective? So that is where the functional assessment component of that cycle comes in. And depending upon what you find, if everything is meets the criteria, you're happy with it, then of course the next step would be the clinical trial, and then the cycle continues. Your findings of the clinical trial, if there is not enough improvement, then you go back to the drawing board, and that cycle of continuous improvement keeps on. So this is essentially where functional assessment fits. So how does one perform biomechanical assessment? As I said before, it depends upon what the implant is meant to do. Is it a joint motion restoration implant, or joint fusion implant, or a fracture fixation implant? So I'm going to very briefly go through and show you examples of each of those functions. So if you have a prosthesis that restores motion at a given joint, hip prosthesis, knee prosthesis, or spine prosthesis, then how do you assess it? First thing is you have to assess the motion at the implanted joint, and you can do that by quantifying the range of motion which is called the quantity of motion. You can also assess the quality of motion, which is defined using axis of rotation. And in the case of spinal joints or cartilaginous joints, you can talk about the joint stiffness and neutral zone and so forth. Very importantly, you have to assess the bone implant interface motion. An extremely important function of the implant is that it is fixed correctly, that fixation with the bone does not fail. And finally, does it appropriately share the physiologic load with its surrounding? So in the case of spinal segment, you have to make sure that, you know, spinal segment, for example, is a three-joint complex. That is the cartilaginous disc and the two synovial facet joints. So it's a three-joint complex. So if you replace the cartilaginous disc with an artificial disc, you have to make sure that you are not changing the balance between the facet joints and the disc in terms of load sharing. Similarly, in the hip, knee, and elbow examples, one has to worry about stress shielding. And so those are the things one would assess in functional biomechanical assessment. So taking an example of a total disc replacement, you can, after the ASTM assessment is done, meaning that it is going to not create debris, it is not going to fall apart before in 10 million cycles and so forth, you should really look at using human cadaveric specimens to assess whether it really is going to restore motion. What kind of motion are you going to restore? What is the quality of motion restored? And those are the questions that are the end users, the surgeons want to know answers to those. And for a good reason, because even if you restore the range of motion, but if you do not restore quality of motion, that is going to be reflected in eventual long-term patient outcomes. So, for example, you know, one would actually implant, when you characterize the motion segment in its native state, then implant the prosthesis and go through the load displacement behavior. So here is, for example, on the left, an implanted disc is moving under fluoroscopy. And on the right, we are quantifying the load displacement curve, which is called the kinematic signature. And there are ways of identifying the quantitatively or quantifying the characteristics of this kinematic signature, which you can use to compare device A versus device B, or within the same device, compare before and after, compare the characteristics of the native segment and of the implanted segment to see how well have you restored the native kinematics. And this is simply the quantity of motion. So you can look at how much motion is being restored in the physiologic modes of activities. An important component of quality of motion is the assessment of axis of rotation. And here we have radiographic analysis that gives you center of rotation of the, on the left is the native segment, and on the right is an implanted segment, and you can actually quantify you in a local coordinate system whether you have maintained the native kinematic characteristics or not. And in this analysis example is taken from our good friends in medical metrics. But you can also do it in the laboratory using more advanced technology. Moving on to the second type of implants, these are the joint fusion implants. These are used to block the motion at a given joint. One has to characterize these implants in terms of in using physiologic loads and worst case conditions. You have to also worry about interface motion. You know, for an example of a joint fusion implant is a intervertebral cage in the case of spine. And so the cage, the most important thing that you have to look at in the cage is how is the cage fixated to the end plate of the vertebral body. And if there is motion there, then you're not going to block any joint motion. So how is that joint motion is being blocked by using a cage design, the treatment of the cage, which can encourage bony ingrowth and block the motion. So all those things can be analyzed in a biomechanical setting. And of course, from the FDA's point of view, or you had to always compare your implant ability to the gold standard. So here's, for example, an example in spine is on the left is a native segment. Then in the middle, you have an inner body device with the posterior pedicle screw system, then an inner body device by itself. However, the wings have been deployed, so that's a standalone cage, and just a posterior view. So a pedicle screw system is posteriorly applied is the gold standard, and you want to compare how well your fusion device, which is the device in the right panel, how well does that device immobilize the motion compared to the gold standard, which is the pedicle screw system? Because these are the questions that the spine surgeons are going to ask you. And you know, the cool thing about using fluoroscopy is that you can actually see what is going on live, and that's the best way to show it to the surgeons, because they are used to seeing x-rays. They don't like bar graphs. But so if you can present your result in the form that appeals to the surgeon, that is the best way to present your results. And these are the standard range of motion bar graphs, essentially comparing the motion that you get under physiologic load in the intact native segment, which is in dark blue, compared to all the other different constructs, and you can actually know, figure out. Typical FDA definition of fusion is about less than 3 to 5 degrees. So you can see that all of these bars are under 2 degrees. So as long as you can show that your design is as good as your predicate in a biologic, when implanted in a biologic environment, you're doing well. As I said before, the interface of the cage with the bone is important. In this case, you can see that there's a gapping going on, at least in an immediate postoperative environment, when the bony ingrowth hasn't taken place. As the patient extends in the back, you can see the vertebral body lifting off from this threaded cage. It's funny, our booth is right next to the hand guys. So one of the things we can do is look at the carpal motions in the laboratory. One of the very important issues in the wrist, people who treat wrist bones, is the scapholunate instability. So in one of these projects we undertook, the question was, how well does, or what happened if the scapholunate ligament, which is the stabilizing ligament, is disrupted? What happens to the motion of the two carpal bones, and how does a new device limit that motion and promote fusion? And so one of the things, you know, in this case, that we're just showing an alternate, a pre-existing K-wire technique. So we had to come up with a design in the laboratory, an apparatus that will simulate a dart throwing motion. And so we spent a lot of time figuring out what type of motion it is. We had to go and throw some darts. So it turns out you have radial deviation and ulnar deviation motions. So of extension and radial deviation and flexion and ulnar deviation. In that dart throwing. So we had to, our engineers, I'm an engineer myself, but Bob and Dr. Maturi, they came up with this apparatus that we can actually cycle the wrist, and by mounting individual targets, optoelectronic targets to scaphoid, lunate, and radius and ulna, and capitate, we are able to track the three-dimensional motion of these bones optoelectronically, as well as in using digital fluoroscopy. So you can then assess the native motion between these bones. We can then do a scapholunate resection, ligament resection, and look at the immediate instability, and then apply whatever the apparatus is to that you're assessing, and to see how well does that fixation work. And of course, we had always compared to the gold standard treatment. The third type of implant is the fracture fixation implant. Again, assess it under physiologic loads, worst case condition, and comparing to gold standard. Here is an example of a project we did, looking at long osteotomy here. Extended trochanteric osteotomy. This is an osteotomy you perform if you are going to revise a cemented hip prosthesis. Because you cannot take it out, you have to actually create an osteotomy in this way, and then remove the stem, and then you put in a new stem, and then you have to fix that because you have created a fracture. So how the current standard, gold standard, is to use these three wires. And somebody came up with an idea of using a plate and maybe one or two wires to see how well does that work. So our question was, how do we come up with the correct physiologic loading model in the laboratory that simulates the forces and moments that the patient will experience as he or she walks postoperatively. So this is a very simple but yet elegant technique, where we all heard that during walking in a single limb stance, each of our hip joint has 2 to 3 times the body weight is going through the hip joint. So how do you create that in the laboratory? So you create that by using this offset technique, where we are simulating the abductor muscle, the hip joint, and that creates 3 times the body weight, depending upon the offset distance, which and the mechanics is shown on the left, creates the appropriate physiologic load on that implant. And you can then measure, how do you measure the efficacy of a fracture fixation implant is by measuring the micro motion or motion between fracture fragments. And that is done using these LVDTs. These are fine sensors that can sense up to a tenth of a millimeter accuracy and reliability. I want to show you very briefly an advanced technology where that allows intra-articular motion assessment. For example, in the hip, in a laboratory, if you're working with cadavers, there is no way without this technology to assess what is going on inside the joint without opening up the capsule. And so, and same thing in the spine. If you want to monitor the kinematics, what is going on between the facet joints, between the articular facets, or how is your implant changing the foramen space in a dynamic environment, as the patient flexes and extends, what is going on in the canal or in the foramen? There is no way for you to assess it without having access to this kind of a technology. So without going into too many details, what we do is we work with 3D specimen-specific anatomic models based upon CT reconstruction. We can also do it using MRI. And then you drive that anatomic model using the specimen's own kinematic response that we measure in the laboratory. And when you combine the two things together, that gives you a very powerful technique to look into, cut different sections and look inside the joint. So for example, in the cervical spine, you can define the contacting facet areas and then actually quantify how the areas are changing during flexion and extension. So as you would expect, in flexion, the contact facet areas, the contact area goes down, meaning the pressures will go up, and in extension, the contact area goes up. You can look at, you can define the points that define the foramen, and you can monitor what is going on in the foraminal space as the person is flexing and extending the spine. And the next step of this is to use it in a patient-specific application. We are not quite there yet, but certainly if you are interested in assessing an implant and how well it is going to relieve stenosis, you don't want to do experiments on humans, obviously, so this is where we come in using this technology. This is an example of application of the same technology to the hip. This is going on inside the hip joint after capsulotomy. Just to show you, we can actually measure the gapping between the acetabular cup and the head of the femur. You can monitor the changes in lengths of the various ligaments, including capsular ligaments. So this is just an example showing what you can look at. This is just another view. And you can cut the model in any which way and look inside the joint. So in summary, functional biomechanical assessment is complementary to ASTM testing that Dawn and her group does. It identifies distinguishing product characteristics and it compares how does it function, how does it differ from other products. And like I said before, these are the questions surgeons want answers to. And of course, it provides ideas for improving your product design and perhaps coming up with completely new design ideas. Thank you very much.